So I'm wondering, where are we in terms of the technologies, since there are so many around us?
Okay, where are we? This is late 2024. We're 2 years into Gen AI, which means we're still discovering the possibilities of generative AI solutions for translation. And we are aware that it can do what machine translation can do and do a lot more, many other things, which are really helpful for translators. And so these are tools that we should not be without, and students should not be without, whether they're going to be translators or just if they're going to be doing things with language skills. I think we're in a phase in the hype curve where it's going down. We're coming off the top where it's been talked up a lot. And now people are finding that it's quite hard to actually integrate these tools into workflows productively. The scare phase is sort of over. You know, all students will cheat on all their assignments, and we're finding ways to rearrange or rewrite or reconstruct our assessment methods. And our book is addressing these changes.
So the book, How to Augment Translation Skills, is partially coming from my doctoral thesis, so working on the supervision of Anthony Pym. And then we have to admit that so some of the chapters have already been published as journal articles, so not everything included in this book is absolutely original. But we did include several new chapters to address the updates and something new about Gen AI. So because when I started, the doctoral project is just neural machine translation. So everything is changing so quickly.
Okay, that's the trick. I mean, because the technology is changing and societal demands are changing for our students as well, and job profiles are changing, we can't teach fixed content. We can't come in and say, "I'm the teacher, I know all about this, here is what you have to learn." And so for me, the fundamental message of this book is how to approach teaching in that sort of situation. And the solutions are quite simple. You do discovery-based activities in class where students with you discover the possibilities of the new technologies. And they do so in a group. So they're talking about the technologies and the problems as they go. And
So we're
that,
not pre
yeah.
pretending to know everything.
Oh,
Same.
yeah. It took me a long time as a teacher to be able to say, "I don't know." It's very hard for young teachers to admit that, but it's a very good thing to say in class, I think. And then you discover, because the students are better with technology than the teachers like myself. Yeah, you know about that. How do we figure out if you're teaching a class, how do you know which technologies to teach? Yeah.
I guess if it's a new subject, the straightforward and simple answer would be doing a needs analysis. So basically, asking the stakeholders what kind of technologies is relevant and useful. So, for example, we did a employment survey with former graduates of our program. So it's a Master of Translation Interpreting program based at Melbourne University. So we asked them two questions, right? So one, what kind of jobs have they landed or have they secured after graduation? And we found out that only 30% of them became translators slash interpreters, and another one that became language teachers or language users. And then with the remaining one that found employment in other areas or doing further studies. So that brings us to the next question is, we ask them what kind of skills is required at your workplace, saying that in your professional life. And the fun fact that not everybody needs translation technology, let's face it. Translators, interpreters is the only group that's prioritized technologies, I'm
This is a
afraid.
bit disappointing for us, I think. We didn't want to find that result. So we thought everybody's going to have to take.
But then for language teachers and people working at in other areas, they prioritize language competence. That's something fundamental. Also, the transferable skills such as communication, teamwork, risk management, and so forth. So we had a forum discussion with representatives from 13 Australian and New Zealand universities who has a master degree in translation or interpreting. And this consensus among the educators that of course, machine translation back then was the new black. So everybody is teaching that, plus post-editing skills, a bit of translation memories wits as well. So those are the two mainly taught components. And then it with respect to the specialized software for subtitling, audiovisual translation, or localization, it really depends on teachers' expertise as well. So do we have the capacities and expertise to offer those components? So that's another variables to factor in, I guess. With respect to, I guess, technology classes, it's quite peculiar on that aspect in terms of assessment because people either can or they can't. So technology itself will tell. But then in translation technology classes, I feel like other than the technological skill sets, many transferable skill sets can be trained in parallel, so at the same time. For example, teamwork, for example, a communication, not to mention the fundamental language skills. So I do feel like it's not just about the skill sets to operate a piece of software. Because that doesn't require human assessors in that situation. But if we talk about those transferable skills, transversal skills, then we have to consider a list of non-human plus human assessors in those situations. I feel like sometimes start with a non-human assessors, automatic
What's a non-human assessor?
non-human. Okay, so technology. Right,
When
technology.
you don't get the result you need or you need, you know it's wrong. Okay, so
So
that's, yeah,
it
non-human assessment.
doesn't work when people get stuck, or it works when people can successfully proceed to the next step. So that's quite straightforward. And then at the same time, I guess the non-human evaluators also include the automatic evaluation methods such as quizzes. So it gives you the real-time feedback, give the students the real-time feedback, and it also saves teachers from burnout from doing the donkey work. And more specifically with respect to automatic evaluation method, I feel like second language writing researchers are quite ahead on that aspect. So they've been using automatic evaluation system to give students corrective feedback in terms of writing structures, in terms of grammar, and then the choice of words and sentence
AI
structures
can be
and so
really good
forth.
for this. And we've got to make it do the same thing for translations. But in my experience, it's not very good at evaluating translations.
We'll see.
We'll see. We've got to find out. We've got to find out.
And also, such as the blur scores, like the automatic evaluation matrix that was originally used to evaluating MT's quality, so the quality of machine translation output. So a few colleagues in our area has quite revolutionary used it to evaluate students' work, saying that compare the student's translation against a model translation, and then they will do the human evaluation as well, and then compare the consistencies be between the two. sets of assessment.
I
That was
really
just
like that.
okay. Okay, we'll see.
No,
Okay.
just because I don't think there's a standard human
Yeah,
reference. So it's like when
perfect.
the teacher would come in and say, "Here's my translation. You didn't get my translation, did you? Therefore, you're inadequate." I don't think that's.
Yeah, fair
Anyway,
enough.
let's move on to.
For example, self-assessment is useful because in technology classes, people, so students tend to start at different levels. So sometimes giving a bit of scaffolding and then give opportunity for students to do a bit of self-reflection can really help when teacher is facing a heterogeneous student group. So also I feel peer assessment is useful because in technology classes, we tend to let students do collaborative learning group work. We assign different roles to different students, project managers, subtitlers sometimes, terminologies, translators, revisers, desktop publishers, and so forth. So different people play different roles, but then the collaborative part, group work is beyond teacher's gaze. So peer assessment sometimes gives students opportunity to do a collective reflection on what they've been done for that specific project. And also it's a good opportunity for social learning. So students know how to give nice feedback in a polite manner. So last but not least, teachers' feedback. I do believe it still has a role to play because teachers can provide that diagnostic assessment in terms of the language quality students generated. So the language quality of the output students generated with or without the assistance of technology. Question.
What's the really good thing in this book
I don't know.
is that
Yeah.
the chapter is free for everybody,
Okay.
and the chapter that deals with at the activities you can use in class. Okay,
Yeah.
there's 57, a Heinz number, 57. Heinz used to have 57 varieties. Okay, of activities.
I feel like many opportunities in that chapters is based on the idea that translation is so. The variance in translation. So there can
Yeah.
be many, many equally good way to translate something.
Yeah, that's why I didn't like the Bleu score and the idea that, you measure quality with reference reference to the ideal translation. It's quite easy to get many activities going where students explore the differences between the technologies and the differences that come about with using different prompts in generative AI and comparing Gen AI with MT and different kinds of MT as well to solve problems.
Yeah.
I think the technology is great for generating alternative translations and showing students, look, you've got to choose between this, 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 and this. And most of the activities are around that basic idea. Also, you should work first into L1. So the students can appreciate the nuances involved. If you're going into L2, which I must admit is where the students get more help from the technologies, the less likely they're able to choose between variants or feel the importance of the variants.
Yeah, I feel like the 57 activities are from a beginner teacher's perspectives can be really, really helpful because when designing a new subject from scratch, I myself can be in a panic mode. So what should I do? What can I do to bring fun activities into my classroom? And then this chapter can maybe give you a bit of ideas and where you can start with. And then all the activities can be easily adapted to translator training, language teaching scenarios. And then you can replace your own examples with the existing examples and then yeah, just have a bit of fun with your students.
I think all of them can be used in the language learning class, and I think that's important. Over and beyond the campaign to bring translation back into language learning, but just the fact that the students are using these tools anyway means that you've got to bring it into the classroom and explore it with them. And it goes beyond just straight translation as well, because it goes into intermedia translation, translanguaging, changing for very different receivers and things. You should explore all these creative possibilities that are part of translation and become very, very easy with the use of prompts in Gen AI. I think so. It does open up a wide range of things, subtitling, etc. In fact, thinking back, the one area that would be for translator training, but not for language learning, would be the use of translation memory software, the so-called CAT tools.
Oh, great.
That is really not for language learning, and translators do need to know about those tools. But the rest, really, you can pick it up and explore. You use trial and error. Find out what works in your class with your students, and please don't get locked into the old idea that translation is something where there's only one solution and you only do it with a pen and paper. And there's a lot more out there. That chapter is free for everybody. And I think actually Riley has made the first 30 pages. The introduction is virtually free as well, okay? So you've got an almost free book to look at. Okay. That's it. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you,
All right.
Anthony.
Go and
Bye.
take a look at the book.